Psalm 27. The book of Psalm 27, the verse 1 to 5 states, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies, even my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should arise against me, in this would I be confident. But one thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up on the rock." And everybody say,
amen.
We turn to the book of Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading the verse 13 and 14. "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus."
Amen.
Close your eyes. Now I would like the congregation to pray. I want you to pray for yourself. We are about to hear from God. There is one thing that you desire from God. Before we hear the word of God, I would like you to put that one thing before God. There is one thing you desire of the Lord. There is something very important you desire of God, that the Lord should come into your life at this moment. That the Lord will turn you round upon this message. That one thing that you desire shall be what the Lord will do for you. This is a hosted prayer. Father, I want to thank you for this moment. This is our desire. The desire of the saints. We pray and commit this very moment into your care. That glorify yourself in us. Glorify yourself in us. Glorify yourself in us. Let your word be rich in us. And let your word be powerful. Let your word transform and renew our mind towards you. That Lord, there's one thing we shall desire. We bless you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Take your seats. Last Thursday, we started a new topic here. And we started studying on the topic, redeeming our time. Redeeming the time. And we try to say, there is a need to set our priorities, because as Christians we become very, very busy indeed. We are busy on our job, our personal life, our family. our devotional life before God, and the work of the ministry. And we say 24 hours is not even sufficient to meet what we're supposed to do in a day. And for us to please God, there's a need for us to say our priorities. The greatest problem we have today is not job, but it's stress. We are all stressed down physically and mentally. We are stressed down spiritually. In the greatest phenomenon we are having today is this kind of tiredness. Very, very busy, and the time is not sufficient for us. The economic conditions have caused us to be very, very busy to meet the economic situation of the day. Technology has made us very, very busy, that we are trying to chase technology and be abreast with technological developments. I tried to run away from Facebook by closing my accounts on Facebook for 4 times. But now my problem is WhatsApp. Everybody's WhatsApping me. On my phone, I have seen a lot of WhatsApp. And they say, you WhatsApping, you have everywhere. Technology calls me very, very busy. Yeah. Another one is WhatsApp. It's another thing. So, and you don't have to put on computer to WhatsApp. It's just your own telephone, your pocket. Good images are coming, nice ones. So we are very stressed down. But we have only one time, one frame of time, 24 hours allocated to everybody. And within the 24 hours, you must utilize it very, very properly. Within your Facebook, your WhatsApp, your Twitters, your everything, your work, the ministry, studies, devotion, prayer, it's all 24 hours. Last Thursday, we studied that you cannot hold the time and use another time. When the time is past, it's past. So you must learn to redeem your time very well. But today we are not going to talk about the redeeming of the time, but we must learn where to place our priorities. Because in the midst of this, you do many things in 24 hours, but there's one thing which is most important, and that is the priority where you have to rely on. Amen. Are you free this morning? Put your hands together. I want to see your hands. I want to hear your voice. Priority is what we cherish above others. But our priority also depends on our perspective. What? We can all do 3 things together. We go to church, we work, we have our family. But your priority may be different from my priority. It's because our perspectives are different. Hallelujah. I have a friend who have a passion of fishing, pescare. He takes his car from here to Mantova. 4 hours of driving, pay autostrada, pay benzina. And fish. And in the lakes where he fish, they are not supposed to take the fish away. So after you fish, you throw the fish back to the lake. And you drive back and buy fish from Porta Palazzo. We talk about people who have priorities in life. They call it passion of life. They call it hobby. So your perspective depends on what you cherish more than any other thing. Amen. He takes his car, he doesn't care how much he's paying, but just to go fishing, can you go from here to Mantova? 4 hours of driving, the risk of autostrada, he doesn't care. If it's poor here, it's not from a poor, it's always every day he goes there. And the fish is a poor, you can't eat it. All the dirty waters are there, so you can't eat it. So you make it, I've fished about 3 kilos today. That's so wonderful. And after that, you throw the fish back to the waters. You come home and looking for fish to buy and eat. You may think it's crazy, but it's not crazy. That is his priority. Everybody is shaking their head now. It's not good. It's not right. Because your perspective, your priority is different from his. And the two of us, we work together, and we all have different, the same time frame of time in a day. This weekend I'm here. This weekend he might be in maybe Bologna somewhere fishing. And he can go and rest and maybe in a hotel, fish, come back. So we all have different kinds of priorities. Amen. And our priorities depend on our perspective. Are you getting me this morning? Great. So sometimes there is a need for your priority to change. Depends on the situation in which you have found yourself. Therefore, sometimes your priority may radically change because you have found yourself in a situation where you need to change your priority. For example, if this gentleman I'm talking about should go to the hospital and they'll tell him that you have a sickness and you cannot drive over 15 minutes. In this case now, he cannot drive to Mantova or Bologna again. So his priority will change immediately because of a situation. So situations today can change also your priority in life. Hallelujah. When you have come to find the reality of your situation, your priorities must change. Amen. Therefore, the priority of everybody is the reality of the situation. Amen. Unless you have recognized the reality of your life, the source of your life, the reality of your thinking, your imagination, what caused you to progress in life, you will continue to change your priority. Many people change their priorities, change their situations, because they have not yet found the reality of life. Today we want to know what is our reality of life. Amen. Work and health can change your situation. When the doctors detected some kind of problem in your life, things can change. You could be a single person, your priority is to get married. But when God revealed situations in marriage life for you, your priority may change. Profession and God's calling. You may have your profession as your priority. You are a medical doctor. You are pursuing to become a medical doctor. You are pursuing to be somebody of great importance in your profession. You have got already two degrees in your profession. You are looking for the third one. Amen. All of a sudden, God calls you to go and preach the word. So now you live in a high decision. Either to pursue your profession or to respond to the calling of God. In this case, you try to see which is my priority. The priority will be you being the NASA engineer, the aeronautic engineer. Everybody who knows you. Your name will be in all newspapers. Your career is a great career. Otherwise, you abandon that and you go and leave five people worshiping God. What do you think? A difficult decision, a difficult situation. Which will be your priority? Then you have to think of it. What is actually the reality of my life? Is my life depend on career or the life depends on God's calling? Will my life depend on popularity or my life depend on my obscurity? Will I be leaving five people and is that my reality of life? Or all that I have studied for about 20 years put into profession, into practice? Will that be the reality of my life? So sometimes it's difficult to face the realities of life. Today, let's see what is the reality of our life. Amen. Are you free? The realities of life should supersede our reality or our priority. We shall explain this. Let's go back to, we are already in the book of Philippians chapter 3, so let's consider that. Paul said, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do." There's one thing, there's only one thing. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Paul, somebody who studied, and he pursued Judaism. He's a strong man, a man who has been given authority to go and arrest Christians. But when he has received the calling, he has to abandon his profession as a lawyer. He has the profession as somebody who knows, as a master. And what happened? He has pursued the high calling of God. He was pursuing what is ahead and not the things behind. Not the things he has studied. So there's a time that he has to what? Abandon his priorities and enter into the realities of life. Amen. Amen. Now let's read the book of Psalm 27 as we have read before. This is the man David who has been called anointed to be a king. And being chased by the present king, Saul, we know the story. And in the course of the chasing, had he in case, he was not asking God, "Give me the throne. Kill my enemy. Do this, do that." But let's see what he said. He said, "The Lord is my life and my salvation." Even though he was running in caves, even though he was being chased by his own friend, he said, "The Lord is my light. If I walk in the darkness, the Lord is my light. If I'm being chased, the Lord is my salvation. So whom shall I be afraid of? The Lord is my strength of my life." That means even when you get weak, the reality is that you are acknowledging God to be the strength over your weakness. Amen. So he said, "So whom shall I be afraid of? If you weaken me with your words, if you weaken me with insults, if you weaken me with things, if you beat me, but the Lord is my life and the Lord is my salvation." The reality of my life is my God. It's not whom, what you do to me. It's not what say about me. The reality we're facing here, the priority of life for David is what? God. See, who, when the wicked, even my enemies, even my foes, came upon me and ate my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Hallelujah. 3, he said, "Though a host should encamp against me," everybody will camp against him. Hallelujah. "My heart shall not fear. Though war should arise against me, in this will I be confident." Now, if you know the reality of life, whom God is to you, when wars are rising up against you, your friends have risen up against you, you will be confident because you know whom you are serving. But in all the midst of this, he said, "For one thing I desire," there's one thing, "I desire of the Lord. And that one thing I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, all the days of my life." There could be everything around you that chase you off, that discourage you, that weaken you, that cause you not to go ahead. The economic situation of the country, the crisis in which we live today, can cause you to stay home. But if you know that the Lord is the Lord of your salvation, the Lord of your supply, the Lord of your strength, then you will say, "There's only one thing I desire, Lord, I don't care how much they say about me. I don't care how much they do to me. Even if my enemies shall encamp against me, the only one thing I desire, don't take your Holy Ghost from me. I will not dwell in your house forever and ever. I will not want to leave your house. Your house should be my dwelling place. For he that dwell in the secret place of the Most High. Preach it. One more time. If you dwell in the secret place of the Most High, you will take the residence, hallelujah, in the Lord. My God. So David said, there was only one thing I desire. This morning I asked you to pray for one thing. So, if now we hear the word of God, you have prayed for a priority. I told you your priority can change according to your decision. When you come to face the realities of life, your priority may change. You have prayed for something this morning, but I know your priority is about to change again. Hallelujah. Because the priority of your life is the reality of life. And Jesus is real. Hallelujah. Now, many people are pursuing wrong things in life, but that is not the problem. We are all doing something which is wrong. We all follow the worldly system, and sometimes we make a whole lot of mistakes. But the problem is not the mistakes we are making. The problem is to realize our faults and come back to God. The problem is to realize the realities of life. Christianity is not how much knowledge you know about God. Praise God. Now, listen to it. I say it again. Christianity is not how much knowledge you know or you have of God. How much quotations you can quote from the Bible. That is not real Christianity. I said earlier on, some of us, we are so busy for God that we are not really worshiping God. Now I explain this. If you go to some factories, people are very busy working. You see them going up and down. I do that sometimes. Don't put it there, my boss will see. Very, very busy indeed, sweating like a pregnant fish. Going up and down. You know, pregnant fish? Have you ever seen fish sweating? Hallelujah. But they work hard. When the fisherman is chasing, they also chase. But have you seen them sweating? No, sometimes people, you see them working, they don't sweat. But they work hard, they don't sweat. So if you statistically show what they have produced a day, they have not produced anything. They are busy body people at the working places. They are so busy that they don't produce anything. The house of God is the same. Believe me. We are so busy that our spiritual production is zero. Because we are doing so many things and those things have no grounds. Amen. We set our practice for people to know us, to say we are doing great, we are doing that. But if God really has to come and bring statistics of what we are doing, we are zero. Amen. Therefore, let us try to change our priorities, change our decisions, and place what we have to place in the right place at the right time. Because our frame of time is very limited. It's 24 hours a day. There is a gentleman. 24 hours. One day you just sit down. What have I done today? What is profitable about my life? My lifespan is there. You are 60, 70, 80. Some of us, we are reaching 100 before dying. Some of us. In good health. Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
This time I'm talking by faith. I say whatever you say, it happens. Amen. So, but every day, every hour, every second, some time is taken from your lifespan. And every time you have to give accounts to the Lord. So sit down and see, what have I done today? Just this evening, before you sleep, what have I done today? What's the reality of my life today? What have I done which is profitable to the community, to my children, to my family, to God? What have I done profitable? Last time I was WhatsApping. Is it profitable? How many people know WhatsApp? What have you saying? WhatsApp. Everybody's WhatsApping. Everybody's Facebook. Twitters. Watching unnecessary films. It's okay to watch films. It's okay to watch the football and we are scored 4-2. It's okay. And you are panicking because they were scoring. Hallelujah. You are panicking. Panicking. One day, Elder Fields. Elder Fields is a district. Elder Fields said in a youth meeting, he said, chasing inflated animal skin, chasing in the field as they get money. Are you Christian? You sit down, waste all your time watching and panicking for the people. Hey. It's good, it's false. We should get involved in it. But we're talking about the reality of your life. Those are priorities of life. But we talk about reality of your life. It's quite different from the priority of your life. Because the priority of your life may not lead to your reality. It may lead to your destruction. Therefore, it's good we identify the reality of what is good for us so that we can apply it at the right moment. Because moments, time is wealth. Time is not recuperable. You cannot recuperate time. You cannot hold it and use it another time. When the time is wasted, it's wasted. You can't go back for it again. You can't borrow time. You can't borrow it. You can't say, Sister Francisca, give me time. Give me your 2 hours. And I'll pay for it. No, it's yours. It's for you. God gave you that. So you can't borrow time from others and use and increase your time to 26 hours. No. Do you hear me? You can be very, very rich. But you cannot buy the time God has given me. And I will live 22 hours a day and you will live 26 hours a day. It's not possible. Therefore, your time is your time. Know how to use your time. Redeem the time. Amen. Amen. For the days are evil. We live in evil days. So redeem the time. Hallelujah to somebody. Always, you know why people chase other things in life? As I started saying, our soul needs the maker. There is a vacuum somewhere within our system. I want to do something. The reason you want to do something is that there's a vacuum you want to fill. Maybe my vacuum is that I want to play football. There's something, I want to do something. So we all get some hobbies doing, we all get some things doing. But then what is the vacuum? The vacuum is that our soul wants the maker. Our soul is crying, where is my maker? Somebody has made me, but where is he? That is my ganza, that is what is lacking. And we are all looking to fill that vacuum. So if you are not aware, you fill the vacuum with sports, you fill the vacuum with hobbies, you fill the vacuum with other things which are not the reality of the case. The reality of the case is that the soul is looking for the maker. God is our maker. Jesus is the reality of life. When we talk about life, we talk about Christ Jesus. That is the reality of life. That's where we should fight for. Amen. Amen. Now we are going to consider James chapter 4, the verse 8. Since John came before James, let's first read John 17:3. John 17:3 says, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. The true eternal life, the reality of our life is eternity of our life, where finally we shall dwell. You can do anything on earth and have money and be big and be famous and be anything, Hallelujah. But the reality of the life is not here on earth. It's life eternal. And the reality of our life is Jesus Christ. Amen. So whatever you are doing, let it be placed towards our Lord Jesus Christ. Every other thing can be priority, but not reality. The priority can lead you to destruction, but your reality will lead you to eternal life. That is the real life. Amen. Consider with me the book of James. James 4, I'm reading. I'm reading the verse 8. He says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Now we are double-minded. Bible says, let's draw near to God, because that's where our soul is crying to God. And when you draw near to God, God does what? God also draw near unto you. We are about to enter in a week of fasting. A week of sanctification. A week of nearness to God. A week of changing our destiny. A week of changing our priority. A week of realizing our what? Realities of life. So there's a need for us to go near to God. Now let's go to the sermon of the day. All these, they are all just warming up. Hallelujah. Now let's open our Bible to the sermon of the day. I pray we can be able to do it. I'm already getting tired. Hallelujah. I say that I'll see how people pray for me. I know you all pray for me. I wouldn't have been here without your prayers. You know how long they have been praying for me? One time the whole church went on prayers for me. I still have the video. It was July 1998. And Lisa, the other side. Lisa was just a year done, if I'm not mistaken. I remember very well. The entire church was praying for me. I still have the video. And it was led by one pastor, Ponsa of Vicenza, who is in the United States. So your prayers have sustained me. Your prayers have made me to be whom I am today. So I thank God for everybody's life who prayed for me and who continue to pray for others. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 14, the verse 16, 27. Let's look at the scriptures of the day. Luke 13. Now I would like to preach. The other day I told you I am whom I am by the grace of God. And I believe you are also who you are by the grace of God. Paul said, God said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 14. And I start reading from the verse 16. Then said he unto him, Jesus speaking, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servants at the supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. The verse 18. And they all with one consent, began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee, have me excused. The verse 19. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, therefore I cannot come. 21. So that servant came and showed his lord these things, that the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring hither the poor and the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the first servant said to the Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, yea, there is a room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out unto the highways and hedges, compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you, that none of these men which were beaten shall thirst of my supper. Amen. And there was a great multitude with him, and he turned and said, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yea, and his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Ladies and gentlemen, today I'm speaking on the subject, don't turn your blessings into idols. Don't turn the blessings of God in your life into idols. How this subject? How come this topic? How come that somebody, God will bless you and that blessing become an idol? It's very simple. The world in a time of frame of life becomes so busy that we are not able to synchronize our doings with the time allocated to us. We are not able to verily time with God's wisdom and integrity given to us to fit into what we are supposed to do, when do we do it, and what is the priority, and what is the reality of life. This is a man who Jesus gave an example that he's about to make a great supper. He's a great man. And he called for people to come and eat with him. And the first one said, they all come together that you will make excuse. The first one said, I have bought a piece of ground and there's a need for me to go and see it. The reason why some of us, we are not able to worship God is because, listen carefully and don't take me wrong, God has blessed us with something. Okay? And we are very busy with that something that we don't have the time now to worship God. So what is idolatry after all? Idolatry is anything that has taken place of God in your life. So if God blesses you with something, and now that blessing has turned to become an idol in your life, you begin to worship your blessing instead of worshiping God, you have turned the blessing of God into an idol. Amen. Now this is a man that God has blessed with a ground, a mighty ground. And the great man said, come and dine with me. No, my grounds are big. I cannot come because I'm supposed to go and put things right. No, you have given me a job. My job is so busy. I cannot come and worship you again. The job you have given me, I'm so tired. I can't come to prayer meeting. What happened? The job has become excuse. The job has taken place of God in your life. Therefore, you have turned the blessing that God has given you to become an idol to replace him. Somebody is with me?
Yes.
Are you getting the scriptures?
Yes.
You have turned the blessing of God to become idols of your life. When you are looking for a job, all right, you are in the house of the Lord. When you are looking for the job, all right, you go to Biela, you go to Bobby Peliche, you go to the mountains, you go to the valleys, and we fast and we pray. But after we have got the job now, let's go to the mountains and pray. My job is so tired. The job has become an idol, taking place of God in your life. Turn not your blessings into idols. Are you with me this morning? Everything that we use as an excuse to worship God, there are things that God has given us. Somebody say, I have just married. I just get married. I'm so busy. Hallelujah. And we watch people who are married, we know that they become cold at a certain time and they raise up at a certain time. We see that, we take note of it. I'm just married, so I cannot come to the supper. But when you were looking for wife or husband, you go and pray unto God. After God has given you the same marriage that has got excuse, that you cannot go and seek the face of God. Are you with me?
Yes.
Turn all the blessings of God into your idols. Don't turn the blessings God has given you to replace the very God who has given you. Don't do it. If it's time to pray, let's go and pray. There is power in prayer. The way you fasted and pray and God has blessed you, for to maintain the blessing, there is a need to go through the same way. I don't know if somebody is. I'm talking about the priority of your life is your reality. And the reality of your life is your intimacy with God. Only one thing I desire. After all things that happened to me, there's only one thing I desire. That I would love to dwell in your house forever. I would like to be your friend, God. My desire is that, God, you call me your friend. That you can trust me. And I can only do that through a process. I want the first process is to have intimacy with God in fasting and prayer. There is a power of fasting. There's a power in prayer. Prayer moves mountains. Hallelujah. So don't turn your blessings of God to be an excuse for not coming to prayer meeting. As an excuse for not what? Coming to the Lord. As an excuse for not facing the face of God. Amen. For everything that you are doing is given to you by the Lord. So don't use those things as an excuse. Turn not your blessings into idols. Bring the same blessings unto God and the Lord will increase it the more.
Yes.
Amen. The Lord is looking forward for that. It's 1 o'clock. Okay. In the time of old, during the time of crisis, political crisis, Esther calls for solemn assembly, fasting. Economic crisis, the prophet Joel 3 or 4 times called for solemn assembly. In time of crisis today, the Lord is calling us for a solemn assembly in Biela. It is biblical that during the time of crisis, the only thing that can resolve crisis is what? Fasting and prayer. Jehoshaphat cannot be excused when we talk about fasting and prayer. Because the enemy surrounded him, both east and west, north and the south, and he saw himself that he cannot do it. He called for solemn assembly. Amen. If you are really in crisis, God is calling us for a solemn assembly that we should fast and pray and seek him. When we're fasting and prayer is a spiritual discipline. Last month, when we were studying on spiritual discipline in Thursday, or last 2 months, the last part of our studies, I did not bring it out because I promised that if spiritual discipline deal with fasting and prayer. I did not teach that one. I told them I'll teach it when we are about to go to Bobby Pelliche. But unfortunately, my time has shifted and I couldn't come to Thursday prayer Bible study 2 times within these days and I could not teach it. But I just want to set the mind of those who are about to go to fasting and prayer, who are counting to seek the face of God, who are counting to send their blessings before God for an increase, and those who are seeking that God should take them out of the crisis and bring them to a place of comfort. When you are about to fast, most people go to fasting and still miss the mark. Because they go to fasting only because others are going. But don't go because others are going. Go with a project, with objective, with a purpose. If you are about to leave, we are entering, right from here, we are entering into the week of fasting, a week of special sanctification. Have a purpose. Write it down. Meditate upon it. In every prayer topic, put your purpose in it. Put like a boss, put it in it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Lord will come in. And you see the arm of God. The mighty hand of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, I'm encouraging you, those who are even who are going after this message, begin to think of it. Please, don't go because you want to try. I've not fasted. A lady told me I've not done it before, so I just want to go and see what will happen. Don't just go and see. Otherwise, you'll be seeing people as they are praying. First, you will not be praying. Go with an aim, with a goal, a strong goal. The one that you think nobody can do it. But God can do it.
Amen.
Situations that the doctors have canceled your name, and you will say, God, place my name back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, my God, go with an aim.
Amen.
Number two, when you go, expect an answer.
Amen.
People go, they pray because they thought it's not, let me just go and just pray to God. I have this aim. But when you go, know that my God said he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above my expectation. Therefore, God is going to do it more. So, be in an expectation. Fast and pray with an expectation. Knowing that it has happened already in my life. We want people to go there with faith. So we can have testimonies. And your testimonies will cause others to be there. We want it to be the miracle of God.
Hallelujah.
Go there with an objective. Go there with an expectation. This message is only preparing you spiritually. Therefore, from henceforth, from today, begin to prepare yourself spiritually. Don't get involved into too much fatigue. But in this time of preparation, let your mind always be on the Lord. Don't wait until Thursday before you begin to read the Word of God. Begin to study the Word of God and let God begin to speak to you spiritually in His Word. Turn yourself, now, turn your priority of the week into the realities of the week. Amen.
Amen.
Maybe if you have to do an overtime, you can just say, no, come back home early. Prepare your mind. If you have films, you watch, or maybe Raiuno at 8:30, Raiduwe at 8:45, put them aside now. Prepare the mind, because the reality of the week is for you to dwell in the house. The reality of the week is to face God. The reality of the week is to hear from God. The reality of the week is to witness God. The reality of the week is to see God by the face. That's the reality. The reality is not the film. The film, if they don't watch it, if you don't watch it, they'll show it again. They will show it. You know, there are films I watched about 3 times or 4 times already. So put them aside. Concentrate on the Lord for the week. Even if you don't have the chance of going because of one thing or the other, be part and parcel of the system. Hallelujah. Be part and parcel of the system. It's a time of consecration for the church. Hallelujah. Even though you may not have the opportunity of going, but you are part of the consecration. Therefore, let the week be a week of consecration.
Amen.
Consecrate yourself unto the Lord. And prepare yourself spiritually. Have faith that the Lord will do it. It's one of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, I will not hold you too much because there are many things to do this week. All I want you to understand is this. When the Lord is blessing you, know the reality of your blessing. Know the real source of your blessing. And don't turn that blessing to become an idol for you to worship and replace God. And don't take things that are not important in life to become your priorities. Let the reality of life be your priority. And the life eternal is Christ Jesus. So let Christ Jesus be the reality and the priority of your life, and the Lord will bless you. Amen. At this moment of life, we will be on our feet. There is a confidence in the land. There is a confidence in the land. There is a confidence in the house. There is a power in the place. The Spirit of God is in the place. We will enter into a time of prayer. We'll be led by our deaconess, as usual, in a short prayer. That the Lord will change our priorities to the realities of our life. That the Spirit of God within us, our soul that is always looking for its maker, that is the reality of life. The vacuum created by lack of God in our life, that vacuum, God will fill the vacuum with His presence.
Amen.
Our prayer this afternoon is that God is going to cause us to understand, open our understanding to our blessings, that we will not place our blessings as an idol, that will take the place of God in our life.
Amen.
To be changed.
The Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord. The soul is always looking for its breakthrough. The soul always desires to hear from its breakthrough. The soul always desires even to listen to its breakthrough. Now we are going to pray. The Bible says that when God created the heaven and the earth was without form, not a void, but the spirit of the living God moved upon the surface of the earth. And the thing that was without form received form. And the thing that was disorder received order. We are going to pray this afternoon that the spirit of the living God is going to move upon the surface of our mind. It is going to move upon the surface of our heart. The earth is orderly in our life. There's going to be order. Prayer in the name of Jesus. Prayer in the name of Jesus. Prayer in the name of Jesus. Yes, Father, in the name of Jesus. My Lord, I look unto you, O Lord. You are my blesser. You are my redeemer. You are my father. You are my shepherd. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Once again, we are going to pray. As we are in the week,